Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions About Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week we return to Dorothy McGuire. It's part six of our Acteurist Oeuvre-view. We'll be talking about two films made on loan during the early 50s. I Want You, 1951, and Invitation, 1952. After that, stay tuned. We'll have Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto. We went to see a couple of films directed by Hungarian director Marta Mészáros, 9 months, and The Two of Them. These are both from the mid to late 1970s, and we'll have a few words to say about each of those films, I believe. Right now, let's go right into Dorothy McGuire. Start out with a reading from Leonard Maltin on I Want You. He gives this film 3 stars out of a possible 4. Dated, yet still touching Americana.
Does dated mean here that it deals with a contemporary subject? Is everything ever that deals with a contemporary subject going to be dated?
We'll never know for sure.
We could do a seance. Or is he still alive?
He's still alive.
Okay, but a seance wouldn't help then.
We don't have access to him.
We could email him.
What did you mean when you called all these movies dated? Dated, yet still touching Americana, detailing effects of the Korean War on a small-town family, an artifact of its era, with fine performances all around. Screenplay by Irwin Shaw. The director was Mark Robson, and the cast list, Dana Andrews, Dorothy McGuire, Farley Granger, Peggy Dow, Robert Keith, Mildred Dunnock, Martin Milner, Ray Collins, Jim Backus.
So, artifact of its era expands upon the dated thought. However, it's unclear to me whether he thinks that some films dealing with contemporary subjects are not dated. Would the best years of our lives, would that transcend its era?
Well, he didn't call that dated, I don't think.
Well, what do you think then? Do you think that this, compared to best years of our lives, is dated? And what would that mean? Hold that thought, because first we should talk about who made this movie and why.
So it is made by Samuel Goldwyn, and it is a sequel of sorts to The Best Years of Our Lives.
Well, not really. It's not the same family.
No, but a spiritual sequel.
I found an article on the TCM site from 2006 on this movie. I don't think I'd ever really, well, I'd never given it any thought, so I had definitely never realized that Goldwyn was always trying to top The Best Years of Our Lives in a way similar to Selznick trying to top Gone with the Wind. Its cultural impact, its Academy Awards, its meaning for him personally as a producer. It was inspired by his son, Sam Jr., being called back to active duty during the Korean War. He had wanted to reunite personnel from The Best Years of Our Lives, but for various reasons that was impossible.
Except for Dana Andrews.
Right. Irwin Shaw, who is the screenwriter here.
Blacklisted guy.
Blacklisted guy, but apparently he did say that this movie did not particularly express any of his opinions and he was just trying to please Goldwyn with it.
Well, I think you get some undercurrents in this movie.
The performance of Mildred Dunnock has been singled out in this movie.
Oh, I love it.
She did play the wife in The Death of a Salesman on the stage and also in the film version for which she was nominated for Supporting Actress Academy Award. So why don't you talk now, again, about whether you think this movie is dated, what that would mean, and what these undercurrents are that you're talking about.
Well, I think one way in which possibly you could defend Maltin calling it dated is that the Korean War just has not stayed in the American cultural memory the way World War II has. So it's a very complex time in American history, a very thorny situation they got themselves involved in, and it's really kind of the lost war in the 20th century, because even when it does get used in American popular culture, for instance, MASH, a real cultural touchstone for the second half of the 20th century. It's set in Korea, but it's really about Vietnam. Nobody watching it is really thinking about the specifics of Korea. They're thinking about the war that was going on when the movie was made and was coming to an end as the TV show was coming onto the cultural stage. There were certainly movies at the time in the 50s that deal with Korea, and this is the only one I know of that's really a home front drama of the Korean War. It's just striking because The Best Years of Our Lives, you know, was written by Robert Sherwood, who was a liberal. It does have New Dealer sentiment. You can see what side of the mainstream political aisle it's coming from at that time, but it does not question the validity of World War II, right? It's about the problems that people are going to have coming back from that war, and it's not buying into any kind of super patriot heroic narrative, but, you know, it doesn't go to the extreme of saying, well, maybe we shouldn't have fought World War II. The only person that voices that sentiment is like a homegrown Nazi in Best Years of Our Lives.
This movie seems to have been accepted at the time as a straightforward Korean War propaganda movie.
Yeah, but that's crazy. Because if you actually watch the film, it's clear nobody understands why they're getting involved in this war.
Other than maybe the whole world will blow up as we mutually nuke each other if we don't. That is the reason given. It's literally the reason given.
Nobody seems to have any real confidence that taking one action or the other is going to prevent the destruction of the world or save democracy. Everyone feels there must be stakes here. If the military needs you to go somewhere, you might have to do it. But nobody has any real sense of belief in what they're doing in this movie.
The men certainly don't.
No.
The younger men.
None of them do. So the movie starts. We have a little narration from Dana Andrews as he swoops in on the town. It's a mid-sized, get the sense it's a Midwestern town. Same as Best Years of Our Lives. We're going to be amongst some of the more prosperous members of that community.
We're told that we're occupying the point of view of either a bomb or an angel.
Exactly. There's just so much that makes you feel cozy and also very much on edge throughout this movie. I just think it's beautifully judged. The director is Mark Robson, whom we know from his involvement in several Luton films. He directed The Seventh Victim, which is probably my favorite. He did a great movie for Goldwyn just a couple of years before this called Edge of Doom with Dana Andrews and Farley Gray. He directed Peyton Place, which we'll be watching this fall for the podcast. He was from Montreal. But yes, we're setting the scene here. This is America trying to get back to business as usual. It's 5 years after the close of World War II. Men in their 30s in this town have all served in various capacities.
And a lot of the justification for wanting the younger men to serve, coming from everybody, is, well, these older men in the community, even slightly older men in the community, have suffered, so you need to suffer too. Otherwise, there was no reason for them to suffer. There's some real circular reasoning going on there.
Yes, and actually the credits indicate that this was based on a story from The New Yorker called Wacky Afternoon, which I tracked down this afternoon and read.
Oh, did you? Because what I read about that is that the only thing that came out of that story was the young man getting the minor being served a beer before he goes into the army.
Yeah, it's not even that, right? So the character's name, George Kress Jr., he winds up in the movie, but he's a very different character. It's a 5-page story in The New Yorker. It's very short. A kid who was too young to serve in World War II, not really good enough to make the football team, and he's in his senior year, and he just feels like he's been missing out on thing after thing. Either he's born too late or he's not big enough. He's only 130 pounds. Everyone's sort of making fun of him, especially these older guys who did fight in World War II and have this kind of worldly air to them. The only distinction he's been able to enjoy is a kind of cursed distinction because he was one of the people that was involved as a teenager in volunteer firefighter force. He and his friends had to handle that while all the able-bodied adult men were away, and they even bungled that a little bit. And there's people making fun of him throughout the story about how they let a fire get out of control. And if the men had been here, they wouldn't have allowed that to happen. By the end of it, yeah, they take him into a bar. They're treating him like one of them. But they know that he's going to be turned away and not even served water or anything, which is what happens. And then they're all laughing at him. Then he goes and sets fire to a barn. And that's the end of the story. He's like, let them put it out, those fuckers. That's the story. So that's not really what wound up in the movie. All we get is George Kress feeling inadequate.
Well, that's a very wacky afternoon.
Yeah. You know, he does have the line about telling everyone to stop calling him Junior. That makes it into the movie, but nothing else, really. The George Kress Jr. in this film does not seem like a guy who's going to let his inadequacies drive him to committing property crime and killing ferrets in a barn. But yeah, that's the story that they've listed as the inspiration.
So we get two married couples, Robert Keith and Mildred Dunnick.
Do you recognize Robert Keith?
Yeah.
He's the dad from Written on the Wind.
Yeah, he's a pathetic, impotent figure in both of these movies.
He's amazing at playing that kind of character. He does such a good job.
But he's at least likable in Written on the Wind.
Well, this one, look, the man is dealing with some serious demons. And yeah, he's fucking annoying through most of the movie, but that's the point. And when he is finally freed from having to project this image, I think he does a great job.
Still just very, very sad person.
Yes.
They are the parents of Dana Andrews.
And Farley Granger.
And Farley Granger. And Dorothy McGuire is the wife of Dana Andrews. Then we also get this, as we were talking about, George Jr. and Sr. Sr. played by Walter Baldwin.
Oh, such a great actor. He's in Best Years of Our Lives, too. He plays Homer's dad. He's the one that's helping him with the prosthetic.
They are employees.
Yes.
Of
Greer and Sons.
Right. What is their job?
They're developers, right? They're architects, and they're really getting into the money now. They've got some big municipal contracts.
So you would think that these people are upper middle class. Plus, but they're nothing compared to this other family.
Well, the judge.
The judge.
Well, they're just starting to make good, right? And you get the sense that they're behind, right? As a lot of men were. Their careers were delayed by being in the army for 5 years or 4 years, like Dana Andrews was. And when he's not there, the guy running the company is the dad, who is an ineffectual drunk who tells war stories that aren't even real. So you can see why it took until 1950 for them to really start cashing in the promise of the company. So yeah, they're upwardly mobile at this point, finally. But they're middle class compared to Ray Collins and his family.
This is the family whose daughter is dating Farley Granger against her father's will. Daughter is played by...
Oh, the magnificent Peggy Dow. One of the great tragedies of the 1950s that she got married and retired so early.
What else is she in that you like? She's good in this movie.
Everything I've seen her in, I love. Yeah, she's probably best known to cinema-goers these days as Nurse Kelly in Harvey, but that's not a major role for her. And she didn't really appear in that many. Bright Victory is an incredible movie. Everyone in this movie is terrific. Farley Granger, great.
Farley Granger and Ruth Roman, I've only known them together before now. Well, okay, no, I've seen Farley Granger in a couple more movies besides Stranger on a Train, but that is the one I know him best from.
Yeah, Farley Granger was in a lot of good movies.
Ruth Roman, on the other hand. I just mean she's playing a very contrasting character to the one that she played in Strangers on a Train.
Neither actor is playing a character at all like their portrayals in Strangers on a Train. Farley Granger in the Hitchcock film is a lot more straight-laced than this character.
I feel like this movie, as a portrayal of kind of ennui about war-induced patriotism, it is pulling its punches compared to something like Till the End of Time, that other Dorothy McGuire movie we looked at. I'm just thinking of Farley Granger compared to the Guy Madison character in that movie.
Try to think about the differences in the context. Till the End of Time was made after World War II was over.
So you think it's braver of this movie to be
this ambivalent about a war that's going on? Yes, I think it is.
Even if Bosley Crowther didn't notice the ambivalence?
You'd have to be really out to lunch not to see that this movie is not gung-ho behind the American war effort.
He wrote, "All in all, the running crisis of the Cold War has been absorbed in the cotton padding of sentiment. A straight recruiting poster would be more convincing and pack more dramatic appeal."
That That is astonishing. I'd like to look at a wider spectrum of reviews from the time to see how people received this movie. Of course, I didn't do it. To me, it does not play as a recruiting tool in any way. I mean, it's saying, look, if they force you to go, I guess you better go. There's absolutely no sense that anyone's going to accomplish anything by doing what they're being told they must do.
Article on TCM, after spending the whole time, many, many paragraphs, talking about how it was unfavorably compared to the best years of our lives, concludes by saying, perhaps if Goldwyn had not persisted in invoking best years, I Want You might have been judged on its own merits. Seen today, it is a striking look at the changing American attitudes towards patriotism and global conflict after World War II, and one that still resonates today.
A lot of the most intense drama here revolves around who gets to be exempt from serving in the American Army circa 1950.
Structured along class lines, yeah. Which is interesting. This father, George Sr., goes to Dana Andrews about his son and tries to have him declared indispensable.
It absolutely is along class lines, right? The people that can decide who is indispensable and who is not are business owners.
Dana Andrews is considered indispensable.
Because he owns the company.
Yes, and he has no intention or interest in serving again for most of this movie, and really is just sitting around kind of judging people. But he decides that he's going to apply this even hand to his brother as well, and the viewer may very well question that.
Well,
I think you are supposed to wrestle with that, with both of those decisions.
Of course you are. Of course you are.
On the other hand, he can't write a letter for every young man whose father appeals to him. Obviously, morally, he can't exempt his brother from that either, if that's going to be his stance. But I think you are supposed to see this as a pretty difficult question, the very fact that he has this power, as you say.
The movie kind of makes it clear just by omission that this is not how most people in Dana Andrews' position would handle it. They would use it to save their brother from serving. You have to think about what's not being said by this movie as much as about what is being said. I think that's where the power of the film lies. It leaves breadcrumbs to much more incendiary thoughts than it puts on the screen.
So let's talk about how Dorothy McGuire's character fits into this.
You know, she doesn't have a huge amount of screen time. It's certainly more Dana Andrews and Farley Granger on the screen.
The wives each get a very definite moment, though.
Exactly, and Dorothy McGuire's moment is, you know, the kind of thing that we've been talking about. This is why you bring her into the cast, so that she can unleash.
Let's start with her first scene with Farley Granger, her younger brother-in-law.
Yeah, they have a special relationship, and of course that is going to be, you know, at the back of everyone's mind when they have this huge falling out.
And I remember the first time I watched this with you, and then again watching it for this episode. It's interesting because their characters are alone in a bedroom in this first exchange. He's hitting her up for money.
So he can take Peggy Dow out, yes.
I don't know. Probably not intentional, but regardless, the fact that Farley Granger isn't that young and Dorothy McGuire is still very attractive, she's not that old, even though there's like nearly a 10-year age difference between the actors, there just seems like some kind of possible tension there.
I don't know if I'd go that far, but he's certainly using his charm as much as he can to get the money from her, and she's playing along.
To me, it was more like the other way around. Could there be some kind of crush of the younger brother, or just some kind of admiration?
Well, I'm sure there is admiration, yeah. I think that comes through.
Of this attractive older woman whose opinion he obviously respects, and with other actors, maybe that wouldn't feel like there could be a sexual component, but with these actors there somehow does, that's all.
Yeah.
Which doesn't seem out of the realm of possibility or morality for a brother and sister-in-law relationship.
Yeah, it could have gone that way. I mean, it doesn't, but regardless, you come out of that scene.
Just an interesting energy between them, I guess.
That's right.
Is what I'm saying. Between these characters and between these actors.
It is important. It's her approval that he wants more than anyone else in the film, really.
Well, yeah, kind of. even more than his girlfriend, because he ends up telling her off.
Yeah, exactly. He has no way to fight back against Dorothy McGuire.
No.
For a long time, Dorothy McGuire just, it seems like, you know, a classic wife supporting role in a Hollywood movie of this period. She's going to voice a few insecurities to her husband
about her appearance and how old she's getting.
Otherwise, she deals with the children, but she's worried that that's all she is now, etc., etc. But then, of course, we come to the centerpiece scene and the reason that she would be hired for this movie, which is Farley Granger has been drafted now, is feeling very resentful about it, not at all inspired by patriotism here. Feels like he's been railroaded into it because the judge who is in charge of the draft board is also the disapproving father of his girlfriend, and he's just acting out at this family dinner, this multi-generational family dinner. Off the cuff mentions, why don't they just, instead of sending me over there and...
why don't we just nuke each other?
Well, he just says, why don't we just nuke Korea or anyone else that gets in
the way? Yeah, but then she's like, oh, what do you think would happen then?
Yeah.
There'd be some bombs over here too. And he's like, fine.
Exactly. Really doesn't want to back down.
I mean, it really is a centerpiece in that we're getting to the possible heart of nihilism of the Cold War.
What I love about that scene and what I love about this movie, it's not saying the choice is between, you know, fighting this valiant war and defending democracy and making the world a perfect place or getting nuked. It's saying the choice is between getting nuked or going to fight this proxy war that's going to do absolutely fuck all except satisfy certain political currents on both sides.
Even when the draft board, I mean, it's true, the screenwriter was blacklisted, as we said.
I mean, immediately after this movie. This came out in 1951. The blacklist was in full effect at this point.
It seems that he was blacklisted for his second novel, The Troubled Heir, which chronicled the rise of McCarthyism. It was published in 1951. It also says he was among those who signed a petition asking the U.S. Supreme Court to review the John Howard Lawson and Dalton Trumbo convictions for contempt of Congress. And then, yes, he had to leave the United States also in 1951.
Right.
And so he then went to Europe for 25 years and thrived. But yeah, he had to leave the United States.
Participated in this film and then was gone from the American scene.
Is that shocking that Goldwyn hired an obvious communist who was criticizing McCarthyism to write this movie?
I don't think it is shocking. I think Goldwyn is a much more interesting figure than people tend to give him credit for. I mean, he did very risky things. Some of them didn't really come off all that well, you know, like the Porgy and Bess film made at the
end of
the 50s.
He was very disappointed in that. Had such a great cast too.
And Best Years of Our Lives, again, could have been an ultra-patriotic film, is doing something very different from what you might expect it to be doing. He's not a rah-rah Americana guy. He's definitely interested in looking at America from a perspective that you'd have to think of as at least mildly progressive, and maybe more than that. I mean, working with Robert Sherwood as well at the time, he was not a communist, but he was a speechwriter for FDR and writing some of the Four Freedoms stuff. And that was not the most popular thing in the world in 1946. America was veering to the right. Goldwyn hired someone who was hearkening back to an America that was already disappearing with the death of FDR.
I should say that it isn't clear from this Wikipedia entry whether Irminshaw was in fact a member of the Communist Party. It doesn't materially alter anything we're saying.
I think we get a sense of his commitments and how he felt about the drift of American politics at the time.
Okay, but what I was talking about was the draft board and their Mickey Mouse Disney attempt to explain to Farley Granger about the dangers of communism like he's in kindergarten.
Do you have someone's picture on your wall?
Maybe if you lived in a different country, they would make you put a picture of someone on your wall, someone you didn't even like.
Not your girlfriend.
And Farley Granger just like explodes at them. You don't have to tell me this stuff.
I know what side I'm on. I don't have to hear this nonsense from you. It's really great. I'm not sure exactly what Farley Granger's reputation is these days, but I've always found him to be a tremendous presence in films, and I'm not sure why people dismiss him the way they tend to do.
Granger's on a train. He is. There's a callowness, there's a woodenness to him.
Yeah, but that's supposed to be there.
Yeah, he's very different in this movie.
But yes, this confrontation with Granger and McGuire, I mean, it has to be the centerpiece of our discussion for this podcast episode because, yeah, we want to focus on what Dorothy McGuire particularly brings to the film. I mean, she just goes ballistic.
Yeah, she's done with the whole family.
She's like, okay, kids, go to bed. Mom's gonna have a meltdown here.
She orders him out of her house.
Yeah, she doesn't even say either apologize or get out. She's like, no, get out. Come back when you want to be a human being, but I don't want to see you today or ever again until that changes.
But then the question is she voicing something the movie does not believe?
I think the movie doesn't work that way. I think it is selling the movie short by trying to figure out what point of view is the authorized
okay
one.
And then is that the distinction between World War II rhetoric and Cold War rhetoric, that there no longer is a definite point of view to occupy?
That's right. And all of these people, I think it's believable the pressures they're under that are making them say these things. You know, you can see her point of view when she says, if you're going to start talking about everyone nuking everyone, then get out of the fucking house. She says she doesn't like the idea of anyone going to war, but if it's got to be a choice between cities being blown up and 20-something boys going to Korea.
But as you say, were those the stakes?
Yes, those were the stakes, for sure. You get more of it, too, later on with Jim Backus and Dana Andrews discussing, right? We're going to build airfields all over the place. Why? Because the more airfields we have, the more chance we have of scaring the Soviets into not starting a nuclear war with us. They'd be too worried we'd strike them first or whatever. And that's all there is to any of their effort. No one can win a nuclear war.
I guess your position actually was the Americans should not have been defending capitalism in the first place.
What the Korean War is, if you look at it in hindsight, is America going in for about 3 years, pouring huge numbers of conventional troops and armaments into this peninsula in order to defend a nominally democratic government that committed, you know, a heinous genocide, like executed for potentially having or being related to people who might have socialist sentiments.
This was like Stalinism in reverse, basically?
Yeah, absolutely. There's no good guy because, of course, the North Korean government, we know and we knew at the time, was not any better. There's no real side to pick in this conflict. Amping up a war only made it worse for the people in the Korean Peninsula, I would say. Now, I guess there might be people who are happy that they live in South Korea now instead of a unified Korea under the North Korean regime. It's very hard to justify what they did there. The results were everything stayed exactly the same, right? They did not gain any ground. They didn't really lose any ground. And the war's not over, right? I don't know if you know this, Elise, or people out there may or may not know this, but the Korean War has never ended. That's why the border is a demilitarized zone. There's a truce that was declared in the 50s, but they never actually settled the war.
Right.
So the two countries are technically still at war, and the U.S. pulled out, right? The rationale behind all of it was if they didn't stand up to communism there, then it would sweep through the Korean Peninsula. They might find some way to get Japan. Of course, it's the same stuff even more so with the domino theory with Vietnam and Cambodia and trying to fight all of these proxy wars all over the place with very few positive results for anyone. I just feel like this movie seems to know in advance that that's what's going to happen. Maybe I'm giving it too much credit. Just the way people talk, none of them talk about somehow winning this war. It's just, let's do whatever they tell us we need to do keep things status quo.
I mean, it's post-nuclear and it's the beginning of the Cold War, and there's, other than economically, there sort of wasn't any winning of that war.
Right. Yeah, so this movie knows that, right? And it's not saying we're going to roll back communism all the way to the Kremlin, we're gonna beat those commies. Just, let's do this, let's march in somewhere to see if we can hold the line there, and if we do that and we maintain a fierce enough front there, then maybe no one will launch any nuclear weapons, and that's the best we can hope for. And that is not a stirring message.
Once nuclear war and these two big opponents, ideological opponents, are established, it's kind of obvious that there is no end to that.
Yeah, but you certainly didn't hear that from all quarters at this time, and certainly later on. You would get people in the 50s and 60s saying, you know, we're going to defeat. And certainly that's what Reagan was famous for, right? Talking about destroying the evil empire.
There's also a lot in just in Hollywood movies, a lot of Cold War despair or something like Kiss Me Deadly.
Well, yeah. Kiss Me Deadly is another leftist masterpiece. Yes, this is a malaise that was beginning to affect American thinking. Again, to put all of that quite blatantly into a movie that Bosley Crowther mistook for a recruiting film, that takes some kind of vision on Goldwyn's part, I think.
Well, although you could ask the same question as we always do about satire, then who is it speaking to if nobody noticed that it was this ambivalent?
You're right.
It also makes me wonder, for the first time ever, what were Bosley Crowther's politics if he thought this movie wasn't leftist enough?
Well, I'm not sure if he thinks it wasn't leftist enough. He just seems to think it's not artful enough. From what you read, it just sounds like he thinks, oh, this is just boilerplate patriotism.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know anything about Bosley Crowther. So Dorothy McGuire, ultimately we find out once Dana Andrews is guilted into going back into the army to build these airfields because he's sending all these young men out to die, and does in fact send George Jr. out to die.
Yeah, and of course that is a very intense scene. Dorothy McGuire is not involved in it, but the scene at the bar where George Sr. confronts his boss, who could have written a letter to spare George Jr., and his exit line is incredible, right? And I have another son. Of course, he's never going to have another son. I'm only going to tell him two words: be indispensable.
Right, and then all Dana Andrews can do in response to that is to go away to the army again, and of course that affects Dorothy McGuire.
Yeah, and again, he doesn't make it sound like he's going to be doing some big hero stuff. He's like, I don't know if this is going to do any good at all, but I'm going to have to go. There's no fanfare or anything.
Yeah, but then we find out her despair because she thought that he served his time and now the young men will serve their time and now it's her time to actually have a life. But, you know, on the other hand, maybe just no one is ever going to get to have a life again.
No, she's like, look, 2-3 years, that's all you get. And then there's another war. Yeah, it's great.
That's quite the nihilistic moment in itself.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, this is post-war prosperity. It lasts a couple years.
Yeah, we were promised the fighting would end in some kind of rich and wonderful life for us.
Sadly, there's always going to be this underlying anxiety, even at the peak of 50s prosperity.
Yeah, and there's a sense of all of these people's lives being, I mean, and I guess this is what inspired Goldwyn to make the movie with his own son, all of these people's lives being at the mercy of these powers who are using them for their own purposes that may not actually be doing any material good.
I mean, willingness to engage in conventional warfare at this point is really just a form of sending a little message, right? So everyone that gets killed is killed purely symbolically in all of these wars that happen, being undertaken as an alternative to launching the nuclear weapons that could actually damage the main opponent. And that's never going to be done during the Cold War period anyway. Maybe it's going to happen now in 2023, but hopefully not.
So yes, we also get the moment with the other wife. This is the movie's biggest big moment. Oh, the wives get the two biggest moments, but this is the biggest big moment.
I saw this movie for the first time in the late 80s, I think, and I've seen it a few times since. Just a little aside about the effects of aging. I now find Mildred Dunnock really, really cute in this movie.
Oh, but is that the effect of my aging?
No, my aging.
I'm at the Mildred Dunnock stage now.
Well, she's about 50 in this movie, and so are we.
Oh, Lord. Oh, dear Lord.
She looks really good.
Okay. I'm not there with you yet. And I'm definitely not there for Robert Keith. You're looking better to me than Robert Keith, Dave. But anyway, this is a great scene, and she's been building up to it.
Oh, yeah. She's been sighing under her breath every time this idiot talks.
A difference. Like, I'm not overly familiar with The Best Years of Our Lives. I think I've seen it 3 or 4 times. It's been a while. But it feels to me like a difference between that, another difference between that movie and this one is relationships, although troubled, family relationships seem much stronger in that movie. You don't agree?
Well, it depends who you're talking about.
Well, this relationship seems just horrible. Like, there's just, like, nothing beneath it for these characters. Like, they don't even like each other. Their marriage is entirely empty.
That's true, but of course in Best Years of Our Lives, you do have Dana Andrews Andrews and Virginia Mayo, that marriage is not so good. Yeah, if you're comparing it to Frederick March's marriage, then sure. But even in that movie, right, you've got that scene pretty close to the beginning when Frederick March comes home and he presents his teenage son with a samurai sword and these other tokens of victory. And the son is like, thanks for these interesting things, Dad. But, you know, that does link the two movies. These accoutrements of war, just nobody cares. Nobody's impressed by this. And I wish the world was like that entirely. But, you know, that's not the world that existed beyond the screens in 1951.
Well, Robert Keith doesn't think that's the world, clearly. That's why he's got all this junk memorabilia up. And you do feel for him. You do understand why he's had to project this manliness. But you're also made to understand both the utter pathetic hollowness beneath that and the harmfulness of it.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, he makes some disgusting statements, you know, at the dinner table, kill a lot of them.
Yeah, but there's not even anything to back that up in his own experience. It's just, he's just sheerly...
Well, he's overcompensating.
Spouting rhetoric.
It's a classic case of overcompensating. That's what I like the most about this movie, is that he's been waiting to be called on it, and it would have liberated him from that pose if anyone had just said something to him 20, 30 years earlier. Unfortunately, it took until Farley Granger's induction into the service before someone finally did, and he looks so relieved.
Oh my god, and she says to him, you were proud when our other son died.
Yeah. Now, was he really? Or did he feel like he had to just pretend to be?
But what a horrifying thing to say.
Exactly.
This marriage is the worst. It's not even just hollow. It's worse.
No, it's pretty bad, right?
They hate each other. Or she hates him.
Yeah, and she...
Because of this faux masculinity he's been projecting the whole time.
Yeah, but it also speaks to, as you say, a problem between them. If she had cared enough to challenge him on this 30 years ago, maybe things would have gone differently, you know?
Well, they're each fulfilling their gender roles.
Yeah, but she's had enough at this point. She tears down all the stuff. You get the follow-up scene with Dad telling Dana Andrews, you may have noticed all this stuff is gone. Tries to come clean about this imposture, and Dana Andrews is like, well, no, I knew that. But, you know, you can't really call your dad a liar.
Well, yes, you can.
You can, but not for Dana Andrews, right? And I think that he is speaking for a large number of men in America at that time, right? And of course, it's not a healthy thing to not be able to call your dad on his bullshit. Again, I think that the movie is saying maybe it would help these patriarchs.
Anyway, Dorothy McGuire's lecture to Farley Granger helps to straighten him out and make him accept his role as...
cannon fodder.
Cannon fodder.
Symbolic cannon fodder.
The movie ends with a sort of class reconciliation marriage.
There's still that uneasy tension there. Ray Collins is pulling at his ear, which we've been told means he is not very pleased. You know, he has to bow to the exigencies of the moment.
There are unfortunate aspects about this relationship too, though. I mean, we are given to understand that Peggy Dow was only in college in order to meet a class-suitable husband.
True to life.
Yes, I'm not saying it's not, but I am saying she's not gonna get to read her list of books now, that she's just marrying this guy she's sexually attracted to who's going into the army.
It's true. I don't know. Maybe she'll read the books anyway.
No, she won't. She'll have kids and raise a family if she's lucky and he doesn't die.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm saying. We have no idea what's gonna happen. George Jr.
So you're hoping victim. You're hoping he dies so she can read her list of books.
I do like them as a couple, so I hope that he makes it, and I hope that she manages to make some time to read the Iliad and all those other books on the list
while she's tending to their children, or maybe just waiting for him to get back.
Well, they'll have servants, right? She's rich. So don't forget about
that.
Well,
I hope her dad is going to help them out.
It seems like it.
She'll get a nanny, which segues us into the second film.
Back to Leonard Maltin for his blurb on Invitation. Society tearjerker decked out in MGM gloss about invalid McGuire. Her father, Louis Calhern, tries to buy Johnson to romance dying daughter. Memorable theme by Bronislaw Kaper, which was originally used in A Life of Her Own. The director, Gottfried Reinhardt. The cast, Van Johnson, Dorothy McGuire, Louis Calhern, Ray Collins, Ruth Roman. The rating, 2.5 stars out of a possible 4.
Do you know who Gottfried Reinhardt is?
I don't, actually.
Son of Max.
Okay, well, I was gonna say that, but I figured that would be reductionist. Did he direct a lot of movies?
A Oeuvre-view, he was also a producer.
Right off the bat here, I want to maybe beat you to the punch and say two words, Henry James.
Yeah, obviously. And interesting that we encountered in our Margaret Sullivan series, a movie from this era that was also in this general ballpark, the dying heroine who may or may not be being betrayed by the people around her.
No Sad Songs for Me.
Yeah, I definitely like No Sad Songs for Me better. It had more twists. This was very devoid of twists to the point where I was kind of feeling the complaints that are sometimes made by critics about MGM gloss.
Well, the twist is that there isn't the twist that you're expecting, which yeah, I really like, actually.
No, that's fine, but you know that all along. You're not even fooled to think that her paranoia is correct at any point.
Well, I think the movie does keep you guessing a little bit, right?
No, it really doesn't. And the other thing is that there is not allowed to be any ambiguity about his feelings for Ruth Roman. I mean, ultimately, there is not allowed to be any ambiguity about that, which would have also made things more interesting if there was even just some ambiguity and she wasn't just completely delusional and insane, malicious, scoring points against a dying woman. Which is the whole point of
the invitation.
The invitation.
Yeah, I mean, her character is pretty reprehensible, but she manages to make you feel a little bit for her, I think. That scene where she's waiting for him in his apartment when he comes home after a bout of drinking, unshaven.
Well, she's still human in that scene, but then she's utterly thrown under the bus once she realizes he's claiming to love Dorothy McGuire, and I guess she must on some level believe that or she wouldn't act like a maniac.
Yeah, well, he forces her to understand that it's true in his last confrontation with her.
And then she just goes full evil.
Right, because her idea, I imagine, is that she's told herself that this is a guy, he's just not serious enough to fall in love with anybody. So it's not a mark against me that he wasn't deeply in love with me and I went off on my trip. He's just a flaner and that's how he is. But then she realizes, oh, fuck, this guy really has fallen in love with this invalid. I'm furious.
So the thing about the Henry James melodrama, as we've discussed many times, is that there are all these various elements. As you can see in movies as diverse as Dark Victory, No Sad Songs for Me, and Invitation, you can do many, many different things with these basic elements.
Van Johnson has a real Merton Densher
quality. He sure does. And the best scene in the whole movie that brought that out the most was his scene with the father. This is like a little bit of Golden Bowl with a little bit of Wings of the Dove.
Yeah.
Right? But let's start from the beginning. Oh, well, the other thing to say about it is this is the first time we've seen Dorothy McGuire do a scenery chewing performance.
She does have to flip out a couple of times.
Real big. This is not necessarily how, I mean, she does it well, but it's not necessarily how I want to see Dorothy McGuire.
No, but I think it's nicely introduced into what often seems like a more typical soft Dorothy McGuire character with spiny edges. But true. Yeah, she does go ballistic. I mean, she goes ballistic in both of these movies, you know, at the dinner scene with Farley Granger and in this movie a couple of times when confronted with some horrifying truths. So we're introduced, it seems like an idyllic marriage in some ways. They live in this beautiful Connecticut retreat.
Yeah, it's MGM not fighting the allegations of being MGM. They have this gorgeous wealthy person house and a gorgeous wealthy person life, and she's even getting too many fur coats from her dad that bought all of this for them.
Yeah, Louis Calhern. The one difficulty in this marriage, it's clear from the start, is that she's weak. She's got some kind of physical frailty that is holding her back, and people are talking about it from the beginning. But you don't really know, and the movie doesn't make it seem like this is something that is a terminal condition. It just is something that she's had to live with her whole life, and she just has to manage it, and she'll be fine. It does keep her from living life to the fullest.
Interesting about Dorothy McGuire's status as a star, that Van Johnson, even though this is very clearly a woman's picture, Van Johnson was first in the credits.
Yeah, but you have to remember, it's an MGM movie. Van Johnson is an MGM stalwart, and Dorothy McGuire is borrowed from Fox.
Would that always make a difference? So if the female star was big enough, she'd get her name first.
It's a consideration, because studios want to promote their own people. They don't necessarily want to promote someone who's never going to work for them again. I mean, they borrowed her presumably because they thought she'd be good for the movie, but Van Johnson's still going to be at the top in a situation like that, I think.
Yeah, undeserved. Although, you know, good supporting performance.
The spotlight is on her, for sure. I agree. But he does, you know, he and Louis Calhern both do great work. And Ruth Roman does not seem to have any vanity about playing a maniacal jerk.
It's hilarious because, like I said, the only movie I know her well from other than this is Strangers on a Train, where she is the good girlfriend contrasted with the evil wife that Farley Granger is trying to divorce.
There is going to be a fair amount of flashback in this film.
This movie has a crazy structure and so much flashback and so much paranoia that I couldn't help but keep thinking if this was done by the master studio of the woman's picture, which is of course Warner Brothers in the 1940s, what kind of stylistic perfection just the studio itself could have done with this subject.
It's true. It would have been a very different movie if it had been made in that era and by that studio.
But it does still have those noirish elements to it, although shot totally differently, visually.
One of the first big incidents is that she is keeping a secret from her husband, although of course he knows everything, but we don't know that. Her dad has asked her to come see him. This is an opportunity for her to also meet with her physician, Ray Collins. So he's in both of our movies this week. He was the judge and the draft board head, and now he is the sympathetic doctor. They are talking to her and trying to get more of an idea of how her symptoms are developing. As we go along, we'll understand that they are dreadfully afraid that they're going to lose this race against time to cure her of this heart ailment, but they're really downplaying it, or anyway, the doctor is. The dad doesn't have a very good poker face and is constantly on the verge of flipping out whenever he hears anything about what's going on with her, which I don't blame him when you know that she's got a problem with her heart valve.
Yeah, but also this daughter is very, very, very important to him. There's no wife in sight here. His daughter's happiness is the most important thing in his life, and also her living.
So we find out that it does seem to be getting worse because she has these spells of breathlessness and she usually is able to use a kind of mindfulness technique to get through it. But this week, for the first time, she completely passed out. And this is a sign that, you know, time is running out. They don't say anything about this to her at all. They just say, yeah, don't worry, keep us posted, but it's going to be fine. It's not a big deal. They send her back home where she tries to pretend that she hasn't seen her dad, but
she also does make a big speech at this point to her father.
Yeah.
About how it's not possible for her to do less. All her life consists of is waiting for her husband to come home. That's great, and it really is wonderful, but, you know, she's not overjoyed by the fact that she has nothing to do with her time other than that.
Yeah, well, that comes about because she dropped something, and her dad is like, well, where was the maid? What's going on? Why were you trying to sweep? Of course, in retrospect, you can kind of understand why he says that, because one wrong move could break her heart. But when we're watching it the first time, we don't know that, and it just feels like everyone really...
Well, we actually find out that she can withstand a lot of emotional trauma.
Yeah, it's more the physical activity that is dangerous, it seems.
She does quite a bit of pacing and raising her voice, though. Not as delicate as they thought. I think you are supposed to be worried she's going to drop dead in the middle of
all
of this.
Well, I was. Yeah. I had never seen this one before, and I didn't know what was going to happen. Before she leaves the rich environs of her dad's place, she tries to stop in to see her pal, Ruth Roman, who is the daughter of a professor, a medical doctor who is also on the faculty at a university, and tries to barge in and make up with her because, we find out, there's been, you know, a switch of affections at some point, and Ruth Roman is not forgiving anything that has happened.
No, she's just like, back off, bitch, you knew what you were doing. Not in the scene that she says you can have him back in a year. Isn't that at their wedding?
Yeah, that's a flashback. So she said it the day of the wedding.
Right, right.
But here,
I think here she says your year is almost up or something.
Yeah, and she also says you only got him because of money. And of course, we don't intuit at that point that she means that he was hired to marry her.
Well,
just that he was marrying into a much richer family.
True. The movie does have this double bluff going on where Van Johnson, like I said, he acts throughout like he is genuinely in love with Dorothy McGuire. We see her become paranoid, but we don't ever occupy a paranoid point of view where he looks suspicious to us.
Well, he does. One of the earlier flashbacks, when they're in the car, he's sort of distractedly kissing her and acting like he loves her. He clearly doesn't at that time. And I think that that's quite clearly communicated.
Well, what we're talking about is when she starts flashing back through their relationship because Ruth Roman has planted the evil seed in her mind. That was an ambiguous moment. Like, I was trying to, as we slowly discovered what was truly going on here and began to suspect it, and of course I began to suspect it right in the scene right before that in her flashback where they're coming out of the father's office, right? And then we start putting it together with this dad who buys her
whatever she wants.
And even more stuff than she asks for.
He tries to anticipate her needs.
Right. Yeah, and then I was trying to fit together this scene in the car and put that kiss on the cheek meant. As you start putting the whole thing together after multiple flashbacks and some of the scenes exactly repeated between flashbacks, it seems to me that, well, okay, no, but I don't want to talk about this yet. I don't want to talk about his emotional trajectory till I get to the scene between him and the father in his own flashback. So let's just keep going with Dorothy McGuire for now. So what do we see? We see that kiss on the cheek, which is slightly ambiguous, yes, but then we get the whole honeymoon where he quite unambiguously is worried.
Well, yeah, that's the moment, right? That's the tipping point where he realizes he is in love with her because he's terrified that she's been taken in an avalanche.
Right.
And if he was just there as a hired husband, then, well, he could still care whether she lives or dies in that moment. But he just seems really shaken to the core. And he's realized, this woman I married for ulterior motives, love has now become the primary motive, and I want her.
But she's the one who's remembering all this stuff at this point. So how is she processing? I mean, I guess all we can say about it is that she is seeing different sorts of evidence and trying to weigh them against each other.
Yeah. But we've also seen, you know, what her life was like before the marriage, right? Because the flashbacks reveal she has kind of resigned herself to spinsterdom, or she tells people she has. She's sitting on the sidelines as people play tennis and go swimming, and she can't do those things. Tells her dad it's fine. She can do lots of other things. She's not concerned about that. He decides that she's been protesting too much. And I guess the movie's a little ambiguous on that. Like, would she have been fine as a spinster?
Well, no, because the idea is that she's going to die as a young woman without ever having experienced love, which is like the whole theme of Wings of the Dove. But would she have been fine if she had her whole life to live out as an invalid spinster?
She seems to have convinced herself that she would be.
I mean, obviously it would not be her ideal life.
No. But the other thing that's clear is that she may not be madly in love with Van Johnson, but she does already think of him as a kind of ideal. These people have known each other forever, and he's been involved with her friend, and they run in the same circles, even though he's a ne'er-do-well.
Well, yeah, he's the kind of playboy, as we see, and Ruth Roman at that point is worried about him and some other woman.
Exactly. She's not worried about Dorothy McGuire because she is out of the running by virtue of her invalidism.
Right.
Little does Ruth Roman know. Gotta watch those invalids.
No, so what happens in the scene between her and her father is because she's making this claim about how she'll be just fine as a spinster, that's what makes him realize that she won't be.
The exact reverse of the intended message is conveyed. And just because of the way she positively references Van Johnson's character, he latches onto him as the solution to this problem that has not even been posed by Dorothy McGuire.
Before we get to Van Johnson's flashbacks, there's this whole sequence of her getting more and more clues to the terrible truth of her marriage. There, obviously, there's the one with the maid.
Everyone's talking like there's a time limit on this magical experience that she's been having. Sort of Enchanted Cottage style at certain points, right? It feels like the spell is going to break any moment now. Everyone is bracing themselves for a change. She still doesn't realize that the thing that's going to break the spell is her death, her inevitable death, because she's been given a year to live without anyone telling her this. But yeah, the maid has been fighting with her husband because the husband just keeps saying, you know, what's going on here? Isn't this coming to an end soon? And Dorothy McGuire is like, no, we've been doing so well. We can hire him too. You could be our couple.
Yeah, the maid doesn't seem to know that she's going to die.
It's sort of unclear. I think she does, right?
Because... Do you? But when Dorothy McGuire says, we'll just keep you on, she doesn't challenge that.
She doesn't, but, I mean, is she going to challenge that? Is she going to say, no, you're dying? No, I think she's been given special instructions by the dad. You watch her like a hawk. Don't let her sweep anything up, right? It's clear to me anyway. Maybe there's counter evidence to that, but I think Ellen is in on it.
All right. I didn't see any wise looks or any giveaways in this scene, but okay.
As she thinks back on the development of their courtship, she does. You know, we see that scene in the car from her perspective and from his later on, right? I think.
Yeah, we do. When do we get the scene with her father where she's hysterically, I mean, I guess this must be part of her flashback, where she's hysterically throwing herself at him in ecstasy at the fact that somebody loves her back? Well, that's after Van Johnson proposes to her, I guess.
Yeah, she realizes that this is something that she wanted all along, and the dad is like, yes, I did a good thing here.
It almost doesn't seem to matter who.
Well, no, I don't think that's true, because it's been pretty clear that she's been kind of fixated without knowing it on Van Johnson.
True, but she does say someone loves me.
I mean, if it had been someone else that she enjoys being around that loved her, she would probably have reacted a similar way.
She clearly doesn't think it was ever going to be anyone.
That's right. You know, again, the two extremes of presentation or description of Dorothy McGuire in these two movies, because in I Want You, we're told that she was the most beautiful girl in town and Dana Andrews is so happy to have married her. And in this movie, everyone's talking and she's particularly talking about how plain she is. People do seem to be emphasizing that she's not as good looking as Ruth Roman.
Yeah, she's got, I don't know, she's like Christina Ricci or something. She's got absolutely flexible looks by Hollywood standards, apparently.
That's right. It just depends what gloss you want to put on it.
Yep.
Not even a different cap, because she looks the same to me in both movies. She looks great to me in both movies.
Looks the same. She's filmed the same.
So they didn't even do any little tricks like in Enchanted Cottage here.
You mean the bad lighting and the ugly hairstyle? Yeah. And the no makeup makeup? No.
No. But the final clue, of course, is she gets this invitation in the mail. You know, at that point, because everyone said, well, we don't know what's wrong with you.
Well, yes, this is the prognosis negative moment.
The doctor has made a big show of saying, well, this is some kind of after effect of rheumatic fever, but we don't know what it is exactly. We don't know the extent of the damage and what we're going to do to cure you, but it's not fatal and we're just managing it. It's fine. Then she gets this invitation in the mail, which makes it very clear it has a name and it is fatal and you're just about dead.
Poison pen letter.
It's just a flyer, an invitation to a medical conference.
Yeah, but she looks it up.
Yeah, exactly. And
looks up who sent it.
Yeah, the sender also knows that Dorothy McGuire is resourceful and is going to look into this and is going to find out all the horrible things that Ruth Roman wants her to know. And this sends her on a spiral and she calls her dad.
Right, and then she has her most crazy scene in the movie, where she is just full-on spiraling into paranoia, and also, I mean, I guess you could call this, again, I prefer the subdued Dorothy McGuire performances, but you could call it a Dorothy McGuire moment when she tells him that she wants to die now.
Yeah.
Over the phone.
I think it's an amazing scene. I think she does a tremendous job, and it does end with her thanking her father for what he tried to do and for the year that she's had, you know, right up until the moment that everything burst.
That only ends up making her seem more suicidal, though.
Well, it does, yeah. You know, she says it was a lovely year, and I wish I hadn't found out about it, and now it's all ruined. She doesn't say that part, but that seems to be unspoken there. And Dad is, of course, panic-stricken. Wants to get there and wants to get the doctor there immediately because she's in serious danger of just overloading and dying right now.
Right, and he also gets in contact with Van Johnson, tells him to, by any means necessary, convince her that this isn't true. And of course, the viewer reaction to that is, for God's sake, don't lie to her anymore.
Right, and of course Van Johnson comes through here, and he realizes the right thing to do is make a clean breast of everything.
Even if it's gonna kill her, which is also the Wings of the Dove moment.
And honestly, the movie does make you feel quite concerned about Van Johnson at that point, too, and it has a nod to that when the car pulls out.
Well, afterwards, after he confesses everything.
Exactly. I was worried that he was gonna kill himself, because yeah. He's a guy who's had no meaning in his life until this marriage either.
So let's talk about, I said we were going to talk about, at this point, his emotional trajectory here with her. First of all, we do get this great scene with him and the father when they make the deal.
The father thinks of him not too differently from the way the judge thinks about Farley Granger in I Want You. I mean, he thinks he's not a serious person.
Yeah, absolutely. The difference here is Van Johnson agrees wholeheartedly that he is not a serious person. I don't know, what's the idea here that he's never been able to get ahead because he's been too much of a playboy and now he can't settle down romantically because he's never been able to get ahead? Is that kind of the idea?
Yeah, it's a catch-22 and he doesn't have the desire to, right? Nobody's ever filled him with the marrying impulse that would cause him to curtail his activities. And I think it's in that scene where Louis Calhoun says, "You've spent a lot of time playing tennis, shall we say."
So he's a lot less serious, if that's possible, than Merton Densher, who is very serious about his journalistic career and also about Kate Croy.
Oh yeah, yeah, that part is quite different.
He's just kind of generally passive in life, but he is serious about things. This is closer to the, again, a noir touchstone, right? Or a noir connection. This is closer to the...
like Robert Young.
Robert Young, and They Won't Believe Me. That sort of soapy 20th century magazine story version of a Henry James protagonist, right?
Just like a terminally unserious man who cannot work up any long-lasting interest in any woman. It's held him back in other ways, too, because he can't see any reason to apply himself in business either.
And yeah, so the best moment in the whole movie is the father telling him, you know, under other circumstances, you would not be my ideal son-in-law.
No, but because you seem to be morally flexible, let's say, and you have no money.
And my daughter likes you.
Yeah, let's give you this opportunity and do your best. Make sure that you live up to your side of the bargain. And you know, it's going to be beneficial to all. And she'll be dead after that. And you can get on with your aimless life.
So what I see here is actually almost a Peter Ibbotson quality to this relationship, because they've both liked each other since they were children, but they just never thought of any romantic possibility because of her condition, right?
Yeah, that's right. I mean, it is a very interesting possibility there that he has been, in a way, waiting for her without knowing it.
So that's why, in this context, the cheek kiss does seem like a sincere expression of not necessarily marital or sexual love at that point, but of love that he's been awakened to by realizing that she's this person he's known all his life and liked is going to die.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think there's no question, you know, he's not cynically motivated in his dealings with her. The movie never fools around with that, but it's certainly a half-hearted way to go about launching a courtship. He is feeling very uneasy about this. I have to romance her, and knowing what I know about her, it's very awkward.
I don't know, I really just took the cheek kiss as a spontaneous reaction to finding out what was going to happen to her. I didn't see it as any kind of even clumsy attempt at courtship, although she probably takes it that way.
Well, she doesn't, right? Because they go out for dinner and they're still talking like he is involved with Ruth Roman and there's no changing that.
We haven't talked about Dorothy McGuire's very long, cold, paranoid stare during his whole delivery of this confession. It's almost like, speaking of Henry James, Olivia de Havilland, Washington Square flip that she's gone through here.
When he begins his story, obviously it's just confirming all of the worst suspicions she had, and that's a danger that Van Johnson, I mean, he knows her better than anyone. He thinks that this will be more helpful than the ruse that the dad proposes.
Well, it's like a moral necessity.
Well, yeah, exactly.
For anyone in these circumstances to be told the truth.
Except that if he didn't love her, if it really was just undertaken as a job, then he wouldn't do this, because what would be the point of saying that? The only reason he tells her the truth is because he can truthfully say, "I did fall in love with you."
I guess.
I don't think it would be a morally justified decision to tell her, "Yes, I did take money to marry you, and I don't have any feelings for you. Well, I never have."
That might very well be what happens between Merton Densher and Millie Teal, but we're not given the details. Of course, she does die during that conversation, so.
Yeah, and the big question through a lot of the film has been, you know, how much of a Kate Croy is Ruth Roman's character? And it turns out not at all.
She's
not involved in it. She's tried to imagine herself into this corrupt bargain.
Yeah, she tried to imagine that she is what he's waiting for at the other end of this, but he just keeps denying it in various different ways. for various different reasons.
You have him on loan for a year, but no, this is news to him. She was not a party to the original plan. Dorothy McGuire does a great job. I mean, she's not on camera the whole time because he's narrating and it's a flashback, but in the back of your mind, you are seeing her sitting on that couch catatonically.
But not just catatonically, like the expression on her face is positively poisonous.
Taking it all in.
It's her reaction is the reason that we fear that he's going off to commit suicide afterwards. In both instances, when she has her flashback and then when he has his, again, it seems to me that we understand, although more so the second time we go through these scenes, but that we always understand that he does care for her, but she neither feels that during her own flashback, nor initially absorbs that during his.
No, she really has to take some time to put all of the pieces together.
And to just, you know, get over the part where he did transactionally marry her.
That's not an easy one to get over. She does. And it's kind of similar to his epiphany, right? When he thinks that the avalanche has taken her, that's sort of his existential moment of decision. And same with her. When she thinks he's going to drive off a cliff or something, she makes an existential decision to just believe in everything. And their marriage does make sense and is wonderful. It is everything she thought it was.
Yeah, that's not a thing you're ever going to get in Henry James.
No, that's true.
Never.
Yes, this movie is invested in giving us a happy ending. Although it doesn't take us all the way to the point of her cure. Which is interesting, right?
Well, that's actually the thing I respected about the movie the most, and that felt like the most interesting decision, that ending.
Yeah, where she says, it actually doesn't matter if I survive this operation or not, because...
Because she's really lived.
Exactly. You know, that's been in doubt here for the past little while, because that's how she was thinking for most of this year of her marriage, and then that was all taken away from her, and it's been restored.
But also, we end on this note that actually feels like it has a certain amount of gravity, which is that these people have just discovered how much they really mean to each other and the time may be over.
They can be so much more honest with each other than they've been able to be, right? As wonderful as this marriage has been, forget about the fact that he was persuaded to begin courting her for monetary compensation, but he's also known from the beginning she had a time limit and was going to die, and he hasn't been able to say anything about that to her. So even if there had been nothing about this, you know, job offer, the very fact that he had to conceal what he knew about her medical condition would have to hold back some aspects of the marriage. I mean, all of the men that care about her, and the maid as well, can take refuge in the idea that, yes, she needs to move slowly, she can't overtax herself because of this supposedly just chronic but non-fatal condition. It's just that he knows so much more about it, and he hasn't been able to say anything about it to her. She's been living in a complete illusory world because of that, and he's been part of keeping that going, and now all of that's gone, and they can really live, at least until time for the operation next week.
The more classical Hollywood movies we watch, the more I feel justified in that thesis I considered for my MA at one point, which was going to be on the sources of Henry James's plots, because I realized at a certain point that, uniquely among canonical English language novelists, Henry James seemed to anticipate the Hollywood melodrama just in general, particularly noir and the woman's picture. But my big question was, and why it was much too big a topic for a thesis, was, did that just come out of his imagination organically? And was he an influence? He, Henry James, an influence on these later melodrama stories that the movies were based on and stage plays? Or were all the popular stage plays and novels of his era like this, but he was the only one using those melodrama plots in these, like, crazy, ambiguous, messed up modernist novels, right? That got into the canon.
Of course, you know, I think Hawthorne does anticipate him in many ways there by using melodrama plots for very...
Yeah, but you'd never say Invitation is a Hawthornian movie, would you? In any case, it fascinated me because when you read Jamesian criticism, he's talked about, like, these stories are unique to his imagination, right? And infused with this superabundance of meaning that only canonical geniuses can bring to their narratives, right? And actually
they're stock situations.
They're absolutely stock situations that can be treated very differently depending on the author, depending on the director. But the situations are also pretty great, as all of these Hollywood melodramas show us.
Let us talk about the two movies that we saw at the TIFF Lightbox this week, directed by Márta Mészáros.
Well, we're back to communism, although not really in the movies that we saw. Yes and no.
They're made in Hungary during the Cold War, when Hungary was part of the Eastern Bloc and was under a communist regime, yes.
I read this, I'll put this on Discord, I read this absolutely fascinating interview with her in Senses of Cinema, where she talks about the conditions of making film under that regime, and since then, very complex. Her father was killed by Stalin, basically. He was sent to a concentration camp and executed. And we learned from the programmer of this series that that was because of his Leninist principles.
Yeah, he got purged.
Yet her, at least as it comes across in this interview, her attitude toward communism and toward its effect on filmmaking in Hungary at the point at which she was making films is complex.
Yeah, she really got going after the 1956 revolution, and I think things were pretty different before that. That was sort of a breaking point there, and there was a serious crackdown. I mean, the Red Army rolled in and suppressed a revolution in Hungary.
And one of her films actually deals with this revolution, and she says that it continued to be one of the big sore points of censorship.
Right, well, I imagine so.
In Hungary.
But there was a kind of liberalization under Khrushchev as well. I think they did try to keep the pressure cooker from exploding again.
What she says, yes, and I mean, that would explain why she says that the regime understood the importance of allowing films critical of itself to be made.
Right.
So there were political films being made and approved. And when she talks about the actual process of dealing with the censors, what she says in this interview is they would ask for changes, I would say no. They would insist, I would say no, and then they would approve my film. So it sounds considerably better than, say, dealing with Joseph Breen during the production code era in Hollywood.
You have to remember that in Hollywood there are so many different considerations, you know, the financial considerations, the pressure of being boycotted, you know, I guess a lot of that isn't operative under a totalitarian regime.
Well, she talks about how it was very bad for the filmmakers that they were given a pittance salary by the government and not allowed to own their films, but then she also talks about, you know, since the liberalization of filmmaking, the problem is Hungary is a small country, and therefore we actually need state financing for cinema.
Yeah.
So, like I said, very a complex and measured approach to these problems, specifically with the topic of filmmaking.
And the two films that we did see certainly don't feel like compromised films. Feel like very organic products of one mind, don't you think?
I thought these films were pretty amazing, and yeah, with such a strong auteur voice that it made me just want to watch everything she's made, and she's kind of been making a film a year for many, many years now.
Yeah, it's pretty unfortunate that we didn't get to see all the other ones. There were 8, I think, in total. A lot of them were shown in a small cinema that was sold out, and we didn't get to them. We did get to the 2 that we were able to. Yeah, I want to see more, too. I thought they were fantastic.
And she's worked with, and we didn't even get to see any of these films, actresses we like, from, you know, big names, from Delphine Seyrig to Anna Karina to Isabelle Huppert. But we did get to see one great actress who's also worked with Godard in one of these films.
Yeah, she is getting an actor spotlight, Marina Vladi. And yeah, we are watching the 2 of them as part of that.
I'd like to see all of those. I'd like to see the political films, the diary films that she made about her parents, which the programmer did say she wants to try to bring to TIFF. I think this series maybe got a bigger reception than she was expecting.
Yeah, she seemed surprised that there were return viewers, so yeah, maybe that bodes well. Maybe they'll let her do a sequel.
The programmer, Dorota Lek, don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly, did call these films realist, and I'm often going to have a problem with that term, and I definitely have a problem with that term here, because it might give you the impression that these movies are boring. And she did start out as a documentarian.
I think all she's saying is that she does bring a documentarian's eye to some scenes, right? The scenes in the alcohol rehabilitation center.
But the movies are, these two movies that we saw are, first of all, the dialogue is intensely stylized.
Sure, of course.
But also there is a heightened emotion to all of the scenes, and a claustrophobic quality that's emotionally expressionistic.
Yeah, I agree.
These people all seem like they're demonically possessed, frankly.
Yeah, they're dealing with some very rough gender compulsions.
But also sexual compulsions, not just gender compulsions.
You know, for the most part, channeled through an idea of gender as well.
Definitely. But I mean, what's interesting about 9 months, and then kind of a fragment, like there's a version of that relationship that shows up again with the same actors in the other film that we saw.
It's the same actors and they have the same names, the characters. But they're not the same characters.
I didn't even notice that. But I did notice that a version of their relationship reappears in this later film.
They have the same character names. And so I thought it was actually going to be a sequel, but it clearly isn't, because they're not exactly the same.
No, they're like an alternate universe version of their characters. Like I said, strong auteur voice. And not realistic. That's not realism.
And Lily Minori was amazing in both movies, too. I mean, I never heard of this actress before, but she was terrific in both of those
movies. Yeah, her intensity was off the charts. But in the first movie, ultimately it becomes about this woman needing to escape the gendered oppression of this man she's in a relationship with. But the movie's not even trying to say that every man is going to be like this. Like this professor, this married professor she has a relationship with, doesn't treat her like that.
No, but the pressure's off because he's got his own home and
true.
He can be liberal-minded about this stuff because it doesn't really affect him.
But, I mean, that relationship seems to be working for her to some degree, maybe because of that, because it gives her this kind of freedom. Other men that she becomes involved with, they're sexually obsessed with each other.
Yeah.
And they are in love in some dark, consuming fashion without liking or respecting each other.
Yeah, that's right.
And this ultimately becomes a problem, and the movie actually takes you through the whole dark night of the soul of going through that and for them and puts you through it.
Yeah.
And then, spoilers, films the actual live birth of the actress. That is in fact the actress giving birth.
Yeah, I mean, it had to be, right? I mean, either that or the most incredible special effects ever.
Nope, it's all real.
So that's documentary.
But the reality of it coming at the end of this drama is so intense it seems unreal.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like it comes out of Eraserhead or something.
Absolutely. That's the emotional state we're in by the end of the movie. It's just an actual newborn baby, and it might as well be the Eraserhead baby.
We're going to find a way to get that one on the schedule, too, 9 months, because it's not right now. But the two of them, I thought was even better. I mean, I loved both, but you know, the two of them is maybe even a cut above. It's got two crazy relationships going on at the same time and intersections between them.
Right, and then almost kind of, well, definitely turns into like an emotional threesome.
Yeah.
Between this reappearing couple and this new character.
Marina Vladi, just an amazing actress and who I have not seen nearly enough of. But
stunning. I think she got better looking as she got older.
Well, she was always pretty good looking. Yeah. Yeah, just really impressed by her work in this movie. The episode, it's coming up in several years, but it will be the Godard film plus this one as a one episode. So you'll see two very different performances that she gives in those movies. But that's going to be one of the all-time great episodes, I think, to talk about. The actor who plays the problematic husband, well, there are two problematic husbands in the second one, but the continuing problematic husband, I mean, he's also married, or he was married, to the director. And they're clearly working together very closely to create a complicated figure because he's...
She had three marriages, all of which ended.
Yeah. But this was the longest standing marriage, and they collaborated a lot. Because he's not just a stick figure bad man, right? I mean, there's so much more going on there. He's terrible to be married to, clearly. But it draws you in.
Like I said, all of these people, particularly in 9 months, ultimately the husband just ends up, or they're not even married.
No, they're about to get married, and then there's a confrontation with his whole family.
The fiancé ends up just adopting this conservative masculinist position that he's been kind of closing in on the entire time, worse and worse as they get closer to getting married, right? You do understand, even in that movie, this isn't who he is as a person, this is how he's been formed socially, right?
Yeah, but even more so in the two of them. I mean, his character is very complicated in that one.
Yeah, but like, despite what I'm saying is that even though at the end of 9 months, it's very clear who you should be siding with in terms of their ideas, every character acts like they're demonically possessed in these movies. The sort of veneer of these people struggling to find happiness and love with this endless abyss of misery underneath them.
Yeah. I think my favorite scene in either of the movies is the one where Marina Vladi comes to see not her friend, not her best friend, but the husband, and they have this long talk, and he's trying to stay on the wagon, and she's drinking shot after shot in front of him, and they have this pretty heartfelt conversation, and it ends with this amazing, he's like, well, so what should I tell Yuli when she comes in? And Marina Vladi just says, well, that I was here. And he's like, okay, yeah, that you were here.
Before that, because it nearly culminates in them, what do I want to say about this? Well, he does make a pass at her, but which
not
is,
really.
Well, yes, he does make a pass at her, and it's the whole scene has been leading up to that, and you feel that she sort of wants that to happen, but then immediately they realize how ridiculous this is. Like, this is just, like, never going to possibly work, and they start giggling.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's when that remark you're talking about happens.
Yeah.
It's like the lightest moment in the whole movie when they realize that they're not going to do this absolutely terrible thing that they could do.
Yeah, but of course it's also an awful moment, because immediately after that he goes on the worst bender of his life.
Right.
Everything gets even worse than it has been. Moment where they almost embrace but then laugh it off. I mean, there's actually a moment like that kind of in the shower with the two women too. You know, they almost seem like they could become physically involved at several points.
Like I said, there's this emotional threesome that's going on that kind of threatens to turn physical, but nobody actually really wants that.
Yeah, so they just start laughing hysterically. Anyway, we won't talk about these any more than that, I think, because we'll give real episodes to them at some point, but
this is one of those visionary filmmakers, guys.
That we've never heard of.
Nope.
Some people out there may have, but to us, this was a brand new discovery, and again, this is why we're members of the TIFF Lightbox, because things like this come along.
Yeah, we would not find these on our own.
Oh, unfortunately not. You could see the names of these movies and think, oh, maybe I'll watch that sometime, but having this opportunity...
But then when you hear that they're realist dramas made by a former documentarian under a communist regime in Hungary, then you're like, I could put that off for a few more decades. But no, you can't. You should be watching it now.
That's right.
Maybe should be, you know, at the top of the sight and sound poll next year.
You never know. All right, well, next week on the podcast, it will be MGM 1943. This is one I've been waiting for a long time. It's going to be quite an emotional experience for us because we'll be talking about the human comedy and Lassie Come Home.
Wow. Will that be better or worse than watching a live birth at the end of 9 months?
You be the judge.